Joshua chapter 4, if you will. Joshua, the book of Joshua chapter 4. We'll read the first 8 or 9 verses and skip down later on in the chapter. Joshua chapter 4. And it came to pass, when all the people were clean passed over Jordan, that the Lord spake unto Joshua, saying, Take you 12 men out of the people, out of every tribe a man, and command ye them, saying, Take ye hence out of the midst of Jordan, out of the place where the priest's feet stood firm, 12 stones. And you shall carry them over with you, and leave them in the lodging place where you shall lodge this night. Then Joshua called the 12 men whom he had prepared of the children of Israel out of every tribe a man. And Joshua said unto them, Pass over before the ark of the Lord your God into the midst of the Jordan, and take you up every man of you a stone upon his shoulders according to the number of the tribes of the children of Israel, that this may be a sign among you, that when your children ask their fathers in time to come, saying, What mean ye by these stones? Then ye shall answer them, that the waters of Jordan were cut off before the ark of the covenant of the Lord when it passed over the Jordan, and the waters of Jordan were cut off, and these stones shall be for a memorial unto the children of Israel forever. And the children of Israel did so as Joshua commanded, and took up 12 stones out of the midst of the Jordan, as the Lord spake unto Joshua, according to the number of the tribes of the children of Israel, and carried them over with them unto the place where they lodged, and they laid them down there. And Joshua set up 12 stones in the midst of the Jordan, in the place where the feet of the priest which bare the ark of the covenant stood, and they are there unto this day. And then he goes down to verse 20, and those 12 stones which they did, which they took out of Jordan, did Joshua pitch in Gilgal. And he spake unto the children of Israel, saying, When your children shall ask their fathers in time to come, saying, What mean ye these stones? Then shall ye let your children know, saying, Israel came over this Jordan on dry land. So they built 2 memorials, one right at the edge of the water where the priest's feet stood firm and the waters backed up like a wall for the children of Israel to go. And then inland, just a couple of miles down to Gilgal, they built another memorial, and all of this was so the people would not forget what God had done. Gaius Plinius Secundus, better known in history as Pliny the Elder, was born in A.D. 23 and died in 1879 in the eruption of Mount Vesuvius. He was a lawyer and a historian, and he was best remembered for his 37 volumes of natural history, which still remains to this day. When Italy's Mount Vesuvius began to erupt in A.D. 79, Pliny was the admiral of the Roman fleet parked there, anchored near Pompeii. And when the black smoke billowed and the ashes began to descend on Pompeii and Herculaneum, Pliny's friends urged him to flee for his life, but he refused. He stayed in the devastation to help the fleeing refugees. The distant rumblings did not concern Pliny. He was not anxious about his own welfare. He kept saying, it'll be all right. It will be all right. But it wasn't all right. He was in mortal danger and didn't fully realize it. If he had listened to his friends, he might have survived. But thinking everything will be all right, Pliny stayed in Pompeii and was buried in the molten lava that flowed down from the mountain and entombed the city. All over America today, people are cooing the same complacent theme. It'll be all right. It can't happen here. Everything is fine. It'll be all right. But thoughtful people are beginning to wonder, and I seriously wonder too, will it really be all right? Will it really be all right in America and for our world, with children having children and children killing children and children shooting up on drugs and shooting down their friends with deadly force? When children are killing their parents and killing their friends and mothers aborting their babies and fathers deserting their families and homosexuals adopting and raising those whom the natural parents have abandoned, will it really be all right? When parents and teachers are afraid of their children and the children aren't afraid of anybody or anything, especially in public schools, you have to wonder, will it really be all right? when our leaders in Washington, as Brother Roloff used to colorfully say, don't know the Lord from a lizard or God from a gizzard, you would have to say, will it really be all right? Will it really be all right? On this Memorial Day weekend, let us review our nation's history, heritage, and hope, lest we forget who we are and what we are becoming. We need to know who we are and what price was paid to make us and keep us free. It is good not only to study our history, but as we read the Bible, to study the history of the ancient nation of Israel so that we can learn from their history and ours, both. As a background to our text, we remember that Moses was dead and God had chosen Joshua to guide the people, to guide the ship of state in the conquest of Canaan. After wandering for nearly 40 years in the wilderness, they were crossing the Jordan River into the promised land, and they crossed it with some miraculous power that God had been their portion when they crossed the Red Sea. The Red Sea parted, and so did the Jordan River. It was harvest time, and the Jordan overflowed its banks, and the Canaanites felt secure, I'm sure, as long as the river was flooded, because armies don't usually cross the river in a time of flood. And so they were on the other side of the river. The Canaanites felt safe. But as the priest who bore the Ark of the Covenant stepped into the water, it stopped flowing as by an invisible hand and formed a wall of water behind them and let the Israelites cross on dry ground. The priest stood still until all the people had passed. Then the Lord required Joshua to do a strange thing. He told them to take 12 huge stones out of the riverbed near where the priest stood and move them 2 miles inland to Gilgal and there pile them up in a circle and make a Memorial Day monument, a memorial to God's great delivering power. He actually did 2 monuments, one right by the river and one inland a little way so the people would get it. And so Joshua not only did that, but he made the second one as well. So he wanted to mark the place well. He wanted people to know for generations to come, this is what God did and this is where he did it. Israel had a number of monuments and memorials which gave eloquent testimony of who they were as a people and where they had been and who God was and what he had done for them in the past. Some of those memorials were in monuments of stone. Others were monuments on a calendar, special days set aside, like the Passover and other days. And some were monuments in a book, recorded in a book we call the Bible. And the Bible has many of the memorials to the children of Israel. We still have some today. And from the Bible, Jesus gave us the Lord's Supper as a memorial. This do in remembrance of me, Jesus said. So there are many monuments. I think Richmond has more monuments than any city its size or in any place in the country. And I found one when I first came here, I found one to Columbus. I said, what did Columbus have to do with Richmond? But anyway, he had a lot to do with America. Well, America has some monuments. On Memorial Day, we mark our history. In September 1814, a well-known Washington lawyer named Francis Scott Key was being held on a prisoner exchange ship as the British fleet bombarded Fort McHenry in Baltimore. All through the night, he watched as friends and foe and fellow citizens bore the brunt of shot and shell. The next morning when the sun arose and the smoke cleared, he could still see the flag flying proudly by in the breeze. And he stood there and wrote a poem that became a hymn. Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light? What else? What so proudly we hail as through the twilight's last gleaming? Whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight? Or the ramparts we watched that were so gallantly streaming? And the rockets' red glare and the bombs bursting in air gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave? Yes, God grant it that it will continue to fly. Francis Scott Key intended to become an Episcopal clergyman, but he never did. But he was very instrumental in forming the Sunday school movement that is in America, that's still in use today. And he gave us the hymn that became a national anthem by 1931. He is buried in Frederick, Maryland, and a memorial is on Memorial Day, a new flag is raised in his honor over his grave. That hallowed ground and many others just like it are memorials to the special history of our nation. And we have many, of course, all over the place. One of the famous memorials to our history is the Liberty Bell, which now rests in a special enclosure near the old State House in Philadelphia called Independence Hall. And that's where the Second Continental Congress met in May of 1775 and chose George Washington as the commander-in-chief of the Army. Right there on July 4, 1776, the Patriots signed the Declaration of Independence. John Hancock wrote his name so large, he said, so the King George would not have any trouble, wouldn't have to use his glasses to read it. And he signed it John Henry Hancock. And we often still today say, sign your John Henry right here. It's after John Henry Hancock. The Liberty Bell was cast in England in 1752, some 24 years before the Declaration of Independence was signed. It weighed 2,080 pounds and was first rung in July of 1776 to announce to Philadelphia and the world that Thomas Jefferson's great document was signed. It was broken and then recast from the same metal in 1783. It cracked again as it was rung for the funeral of Chief Justice John Marshall. But on that bell is inscribed a verse from Leviticus 25, verse 10, proclaim liberty throughout the land to all the inhabitants thereof. And we call that the Liberty Bell. That's a monument to the past. It is seldom rung now, but on June 6, 1944, when the Allied forces landed in France, the bell was struck and the sound was amplified on radio all across the land. Then there's the Statue of Liberty and Arlington National Cemetery and various memorials. We have the Virginia War Memorial near our downtown city to celebrate the ends of various and particular wars and memorialize the dead who gave the ultimate sacrifice to keep our nation free. And they are many. What price has been paid for our freedom? Well, a heavy one indeed. In the Revolutionary War, 4,435 men died to set this country free. In the War of 1812, 2,260 died. In the Mexican War, 13,282. In the Civil War, 529,332. In the Spanish-American War, 2,446. In World War II, 116,563. In World War II, 407,828. In the Korean War, 54,246. In the Vietnam conflict, 56,237. And on it goes. Over a million men have bled and died for our country that we might be the land of the free and the home of the brave, rather than the land of the spree and the home of the rave. May I say, from Lexington to Vietnam, America's history has been written in the blood of her patriots. And now we have Iraq and Afghanistan and all those to add to that toll. When Carl Sandburg looked over Washington at midnight and saw those marble buildings glistening in the night sky, he said to himself, there's something here that men die for. Yes, there is something, my friend. It is called liberty. It's called freedom. In the late 1800s, a very famous poet, Ralph Waldo Emerson, was asked to compose a hymn for the dedication of a monument at where the Second Battle of the Revolution was fought at Concord. And so he wrote the poem, The Concord Hymn, later set to music. It goes something like this. By the rude bridge that arts the flood, their flag to April's breeze unfurled. Here once the embattled farmer stood and fired the shot heard round the world. The foe long since in silence slept, like the conqueror silent sleeps. And time, the ruined bridge has swept down the dark stream which seaward creeps. On this green bank by this dark stream, we set today a votive stone that memory may their deeds redeem when like our stars, our sons are gone. Spirit that made those heroes dare to die and leave their children free, bid time and nature gently spare the shaft we raise to them and thee. So we do have many memorials. On Memorial Day, we look not only at our to mark our history, but also we mark our heritage. America was born in Philadelphia in the old State House, now called Independence Hall. It was right next door to a livery stable, and here horseflies and other gnats and creatures flew around, swarmed thick and fierce, lighting on the legs of the patriots and biting them through those silk stockings they wore in those days. I'm glad men don't wear silk stockings today, aren't you, men? And but with handkerchief in hand, they lashed away at those hungry pests, but to no avail. Delegate Richard Henry Lee from Virginia introduced a revolution that these United Colonies ought to be free and independent states, that they be absolved from all allegiance to the British Crown and all political connections be dissolved. In other words, that we become a free and independent nation. Thomas Jefferson penned the document that William Gladstone said was the greatest document ever struck by the human brain. On July 4, 1776, the delegates signed it, 56 of them pledged to each other their lives, their fortune, and their sacred honor. They were not rabble-rousers. They were intelligent, civil, educated men. Some were well-to-do, like Carter Braxton of Virginia. They were lovers of liberty, and they made a firm commitment for which they paid very severely. 24 of them were lawyers and judges. 9 had owned large plantations. 5 of them were captured by British and tortured as traitors. 12 had their homes ransacked and burned. 2 lost sons in battle, and another 2 had sons captured. 9 died of wounds and hardships. Some sold everything they had to pay their personal debts and to help with the war effort, and they died in poverty. Thomas Nelson urged Washington to fire on his own home because General Cornwallis was headquartered there. Nelson did fire, Washington did fire, and Nelson's home was destroyed, and he died bankrupt. Francis Lewis lost his home, and the British put his wife in jail, where she died. John Hart was driven from his home, from his dying wife's bedside, and the children had to flee for their lives. He died of a broken heart. How did we win our freedom? Well, through courage and sacrifice, through pain and hardship, through devotion and commitment to a cause, the cause of freedom. And that's why we celebrate today. Again, I say Memorial Day is not just a time for people to get drunk, God forbid. It's a time for us to join our hearts in worship to God and in thanksgiving for those who had the foresight, the courage to die for us. And finally, on Memorial Day, we mark our hope. We, the 12 stones that Joshua took from the Jordan riverbed was made into a memorial into the blessings of God. And it was done out of obedience and faith and was a constant reminder to Israel of their confidence and hope for the future, that it was in God and not in themselves. The God who sustained them in the past will be with them in the future. From humble beginnings, they became a great nation, reached their pinnacle under King Solomon, and a very wealthy nation it was. And so it was with America. The settlers who came to Jamestown in 1607 trusted in God to see them through. 104 came in the spring. All but 38 of them had died by the fall of that year. 13 years later, in 1620, another group fled England and landed in Plymouth, Massachusetts. 41 of them signed the Mayflower Compact, which established the rule of law and their faith in God. Of course, modern historians today say, well, the founders weren't Christians. That's not. But it was true, my friend. They were Christians. After the Revolutionary War, the delegates met to write the Constitution and form a permanent government on these shores, but they could not agree on the exact nature of that government. What kind of government are we to have? And so after much delay, when it seemed hopeless that any compromise could be reached, the oldest man there, named Benjamin Franklin, suggested that they begin each section with prayer. And he rose up and said, in part, "I have lived, sir, a long time, and the longer I live, the more convincing proof I see of this truth. God governs in the affairs of men. And if a sparrow cannot fall to the ground without his notice, it is not probable that an empire can rise without his aid. I believe that without his concurring aid, we shall succeed in this political building no better than the buildings of Babylon." May I say, we need to be careful, do we not? And so they prayed. And soon they reached an agreement on the basic principles of government and how the divisions of power are to be laid out. America's hopes does not lie in her wealth or power, not her defense, her armaments, her budgets, or leaders. America's hope lies only in her recommitment to the spiritual values that made us great in the first place. We need to get back to basics, amen? We need to get back to the God who helped us in the founding of this nation and in the preservation of it. I can remember as a small boy in World War II how difficult things were. I remember the things we had to do without and the things that were rationed. I mean, coffee and sugar and gasoline and all kinds of things. The color green was almost unobtainable because it went to the war effort to dye the clothing that our men wore in uniform. And I remember the prayers and anxiety that many people shared, all of America shared, in that common cause that we had to defeat these two enemies on either side, one in Europe and one in Asia, Germany and Japan. And I remember the fervency with which that was pursued. And may I say, we look at America today with all of its crime and deviancy and say with Isaiah, in Isaiah chapter 1, verse 5 and 6, he said, "Why should ye be stricken any more? Ye will revolt more and more. The whole head is sick and the whole heart faint. From the sole of the foot, even into the head, there's no soundness in it," talking about the nation of Israel, "but wounds and bruises and putrefying sores. They have not been closed, neither bound up, neither mollified with ointment." He said Israel is sick and does not have the cure, does not have the medicine apart from God. And we can say that today. So, the Secretary of the Treasury in 1861, Solomon Chase said, "No nation can be strong except in the strength of God, and nor safe except in his defense." In Psalm 20 and verse 7, we read these remarkable words, "Some trust in chariots," he said, "and some in horses, but we will remember the name of the Lord our God," Jehovah our God. It's not in tanks, it's not in those mighty airplanes, those F-22s and those mighty bombers that can fly, those black helicopters. It's not in those missiles, it's not in any of those things. Those are good, and I'm glad we have them, if we don't give them away to our enemies. But our safety is not there, my friend. Our safety is in God, and we need to remember that. In his first inaugural address on April 30th, 1789, George Washington said this, "It would be peculiarly improper for me to omit in this first official act my fervent supplication to the Almighty Being who rules over the universe and who presides over the councils of this world." Then he said, "No people can be bound to acknowledge and adore the invisible hand which conducts the affairs of men more than those of the United States." On this weekend, then, let us remember the words of Rudyard Kipling, the famous English poet who wrote at the height of the British Empire these memorable words. He said, "God of our fathers, known of old, Lord of our far-flung battle line, beneath whose awful hand we hold dominion over palm and pine, Lord God of hosts, be with us yet, lest we forget. The tumult and the shouting dies, the captains and the kings depart. Still stands thine ancient sacrifice, and humble and a contrite heart. Lord God of hosts, be with us yet, lest we forget. Far called our navies melt away. On dune and headland sinks the fire. Lo, our pomp, all our pomp of yesterday is one with Nineveh and Tyre. Judge of the nations, spare us yet, lest we forget. If drunk with the sight of power, we lose wild tongues that have not thee in awe. Such boasting as the Gentiles use are lesser breeds without the law. Lord God of hosts, be with us yet, lest we forget. For heathen heart that puts her trust in reeking tube and iron shard, all valiant dust that builds on dust and guarding calls not thee to guard for frantic boast and foolish word, thy mercy on thy people, Lord. And then he closed the poem with amen. And I can't say it any better than he did. Lord God of hosts, be with us yet, lest we forget. And the nation of Israel has, a nation of England, largely has forgotten the depths and the roots from which he came. Today, churches are closing rapidly in England, and they're being turned into Muslim mosques. And soldiers are being attacked and hacked on the street and cut up into ribbons in disrespect for the army and for the government that rules that land. Oh, God, spare us, lest we forget, and our nation go back to the dust from whence it came. There have been many empires that rose and fell. Babylon was the great one, a kingdom of gold, a great city ruled by Nebuchadnezzar, who thought he was God and found out he wasn't. He found out who the real God was after 7 years of crawling around with spittle coming down his chest and crawling around the ground like an animal for 7 years. And then his sanity was restored, and he said, I know who God is now, and it's not me. It's not me. Oh, that our leaders would understand that. Would there be a revival that would start in Washington or at least reach there before it ends? Would that God would have a revival in this church and this community and this city and this county and this state and this nation? Would to God our hearts, we would pray with David, wilt thou not revive us again that thy people may rejoice in thee? We need a revival, folks. We need a revival of God's holy word. We need to have a revival of Bible reading, a revival of Bible preaching, a revival of Bible living. We need a revival of Bible proclamation and giving it out to others that others might hear and know and understand the sinful nature of the human race and how we're nothing apart from God. How is it that our leaders, sometimes even Christian leaders, sometimes pastors, as has been demonstrated right here in our own city, begin to have an inflated view of themselves, and first thing you know, they topple like a rusty, dusty old statue and fall into the ground in dust. Oh, God, help us to be humble. God, help us not to just to walk around. Somebody said, Baptists, the only folk in the world that can strut sitting down. Oh, God, help us to be humble and before God seek revival, to seek a renewal of our faith, to understand where we came from and where we're going if we leave God behind. May I say, we are leaving him behind. We're kicking him out of the schools and out of our government. It's amazing how sometimes a child gets in trouble at school for bringing a New Testament or giving a tract to a fellow student. He's looked down upon and kicked out of school and penalized in all kinds of ways. What do we need? Well, we need for people to get saved. Amen. We need our nation to understand that Jesus Christ died on the old rugged cross to keep our sinful souls out of hell. And he wants us to come to him. He invites us to come to him in repentance and faith. The Bible said, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish. There's that word again, perish, but have everlasting life. Do you know Jesus as your personal Savior? Do you walk with him day by day? Have you prayed to him lately? Do you pray to him daily? We need to walk and live in utter dependence upon God. Somebody defined faith as the leaning of the entire human personality upon God. And that's what faith is, just leaning on Jesus, just leaning on him. And so we need to pray that God will come to our nation, that he will send a mighty sweeping revival, that people will be saved, and that Christians will start acting like Christians. Amen? Start living like Christians and start Not just wearing the name, but being the fact of a Christian, being truly saved, and not having somebody wonder, is he or she a Christian? No, they ought to know just by looking at your life and listening to your language and watching and seeing your values and what it is that makes you tick. Do you know Christ? If you don't know him, this is a good time and a good place to do it. Amen? Amen. I can't think of a better place to get saved than at church on Sunday morning. That's what we're here for. And if you're a Christian but you're not aligned with a local church and you're not attending here, the doors of the church are always open to invite you to come and say, yes, I want to stand with these folk and I want to wear the name, not just wear the name, but bear the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. Will you bow with me in prayer, every head bowed, every eye closed, every Christian praying? And I wonder how many could say, preacher, I know I'm saved. If I died right now, I know for sure I'd go to heaven. Not bragging, but I know I'm saved. Would you lift your hand right now if you know you're saved? God bless you. Many hands are lifted. Thank you. Put them back down. I wonder how many say, preacher, I don't know that for sure. I'd like to know it. I want to know it. We'll not embarrass you or come to you or point you out. We simply want to know, do you desire prayer? I see some hands here and there. Yes, God bless you. Appreciate that. Anybody else? And we're praying for you that you'll come and say yes to Jesus who said yes to the cross. And if you're here looking for a church home, you found it. This is it. Just come and be a part of us. Let's stand together with heads bowed for prayer. Then we'll have a hymn. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this service today. Bless us as we bow before you, Lord. If there's somebody among us who's not real sure that they're going to heaven when life is over, may they come and say yes to Jesus who said yes to the cross. And Lord, I pray for those who are here and not looking for a church home, Lord, may they decide for Christ and here right now. Lord, we pray for our nation. Oh, God, send revival. Let it begin with us, Lord. If you can't use us, Lord, let it start down the road somewhere. But start revival in our nation, we pray. Have your way in this service. In Jesus' name, amen.